Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Time in the Barrel, a Marine's Account of the Battle for Con Thien, by James P. Coan, narrated by Chris Monteiro. When you go home, tell them for us and say, "For your tomorrow, we gave our today." Message found outside the American Cemetery at Iwo Jima. Preface. From August 1967 through July 1968, I was a tank platoon leader with Alpha Company, 3rd Tank Battalion, 3rd Marine Division. My tour in Vietnam was served operating from fire support bases in Northern I Corps, just below the Demilitarized Zone, DMZ, dividing North from South Vietnam. For 8 of those months, my 5-tank platoon was assigned to defend a U.S. Marine firebase called Con Thien, while attached to various Marine infantry battalions spending their time in the barrel, as in the phrase, like shooting fish in a barrel. The North Vietnamese Army, NVA, knew the strategic importance of Con Thien. They wanted desperately to drive us Marines off of there, but we were not about to be evicted. Our mission was to hold Con Thien at all costs. We would hold Con Thien, but many of us paid the full price. I have a deeply personal perspective about the red clay bullseye known as the Hill of Angels, having survived the siege of Con Thien in the fall of 1967. Hundreds of rounds of incoming rockets, mortars, and artillery pounded our beleaguered outpost daily. Monsoon downpours turned the red laterite clay soil into a morass of oozing mud, flooded bunkers and trenches, and made Con Thien a living hell. As our casualty list grew into the hundreds, the news media latched onto our ordeal, referring to it as a little Dien Bien Phu. But we Marines knew otherwise. Within these chapters, I've attempted to describe the battle for Con Thien as I experienced it from the perspective of a novice second lieutenant assuming his first combat command. My position as a tank platoon leader required me to work alongside the infantry, affectionately called grunts, in their trenches and bunkers, yet make contact daily with their battalion commander and his staff. Also, by virtue of having my 5 tanks dispersed around the firebase perimeter, I had to traipse all over Con Thien every day. It was an ideal way to observe everything that happened on the hill, and it was also a good way to get killed. I kept a diary while in Vietnam, recording my perceptions, fears, and frustrations. All those personal things one hopes to look back on someday. Refer to Appendix B. In the years following my return to the world from Vietnam, I was plagued by a nagging depression. Something precious was lost to me on Con Thien's muddy slopes. I started writing to pass the lonely evenings, expanding on the entries in my diary. This writing exercise evolved into a form of self-therapy. Putting my thoughts in writing eased the burden of sadness carried inside me as an ever-present shadow on my soul. The faces of my dead friends gradually faded, and the bad dreams, most of them, went away. Several more years passed before I resurrected my collection of Con Thien anecdotes and reread them. My dear wife Sandra deciphered my handwritten notes and typed them for me, all the while encouraging me to write a book about my experiences at Con Thien. I remain forever grateful for her support and encouragement. Now the story of the siege of Con Thien can be brought to light and not be buried forever in the dusty backroom archives of some military history research facility. The Marines and corpsmen portrayed in this book are real people, not dramatized caricatures, and not creatures of fantasy imagined in some time-distorted imagination. Direct conversational quotations have been added to provide continuity and give the listener a personal insight into the characters portrayed. Thus, the dialogue in the text is as accurate as I could recall in order to honestly and accurately express what was said by the accredited speakers. I felt obligated to mention these men by their real names and describe fairly and accurately what happened to me and to them, both pleasant and not so pleasant. People make mistakes. Others are less than brave, sometimes. Marines are human, not robots, and I chose to describe our ordeal at Con Thien with real people, not robots or stereotypical Marines. I hesitated to criticize or second-guess decisions made in the confusion of combat by exhausted Marines operating under profound stress. In a few instances, I chose not to mention a Marine by his real name if his behavior or attitude was such that he would not be pleased to read about himself in my book. Throughout this narrative, I share my most personal thoughts, fears, and frustrations because, to fully grasp the enormity of the fierce struggle for Con Thien, that story needs telling through the perspective of personal experience. Despite any impediments to official accuracy inherent in this writing style, it does allow for the listener to share vicariously the ultimate experience of combat. This is a story of courage under fire by young Americans being led by career non-commissioned officers, NCOs, and officers from an earlier generation. All of them were well aware that most civilians back home were neutral at best and that some were openly hostile to their cause. Still, they carried out orders, called their officers sir, and gave their best efforts to be good Marines, even at the risk of sacrificing all of their tomorrows. James H. Webb, Jr., a highly decorated Marine officer who served in Vietnam as a rifle platoon leader, company commander, and later as Secretary of the Navy, captured that sentiment best when he wrote, "When I remember those days and the very young men who spent them with me, I am continually amazed, for these were mostly recent civilians barely out of high school, called up from the cities and farms to do their year in hell and then return. Visions haunt me every day, not of the nightmares of war, but of the steady consistency with which my Marines faced their responsibilities, and of how uncomplaining most of them were in the face of constant danger. The salty, battle-hardened 20-year-olds teaching green 19-year-olds the intricate lessons of that hostile battlefield. The unerring skill of the young squad leaders as we moved through unfamiliar villages and weed-choked trails in the black of night. The quick certainty with which they moved when coming under fire. Their sudden tenderness when a fellow Marine was wounded and needed help. Their willingness to risk their lives to save other Marines in peril. I am alive today because of their quiet, unaffected heroism." Introduction. In July 1954, a conference was underway in Geneva, Switzerland, to negotiate a Korean War settlement. In attendance were the Big Four, the United States, Great Britain, the Soviet Union, and France, plus representatives from Communist China and North and South Vietnam. When word of the French Army's disaster at Dien Bien Phu reached them, their focus shifted. France's colonial rule in Vietnam was ending, and it was crucial that top priority be given to resolving the Vietnam situation. The Geneva Accords, issued on July 21st, called for dividing Vietnam at the 17th parallel, referred to as a provisional military demarcation line with a 5-mile-wide demilitarized zone, DMZ, as a buffer. The other major component of this agreement was that elections would be held in 2 years that would, in theory, finally allow the people of Vietnam to determine their own fate, whether to live under Ho Chi Minh and the Communists or Ngo Dinh Diem's American-backed government. But President Diem had no intentions of following through on the election part of the agreement. Unforeseen at the time, the Geneva Accords laid the groundwork for many more years of bloody conflict in Vietnam. The DMZ generally followed the broad, winding Benhai River west from its mouth at the South China Sea for 30 miles until reaching the river's tributaries in the mountains, then followed the 17th parallel to the Laotian border. Where the Benhai empties into the sea is a barren expanse of sand dunes and occasional swamps. Inland, a dozen miles from the coast, the lowland terrain becomes increasingly verdant and alive with rice fields, orchards, and occasional hamlets bordering the river. 1.5 miles below the eastern DMZ border, U.S. military maps of the area indicated a prominent terrain feature 158 meters in elevation labeled Nui Con Thien, which in English loosely translated means a small mountain with heavenly beings. Early French missionaries believed there was something angelic about this little isolated hill mass rising up incongruously out of the relatively level surrounding countryside, thus the origin of the term Hill of Angels. The DMZ eventually evolved into anything but demilitarized. The North Vietnamese began infiltrating troops and equipment across the DMZ into South Vietnam through Quang Tri Province, which abuts the southern DMZ border. By early 1966, as the number of infiltrators from the north increased exponentially each year, a group of far-removed Washington whiz kids and Pentagon planners devised a barrier system of firebase strongpoints to be situated below the DMZ, connected by a cleared swath of land sown with barbed wire, mines, and anti-infiltration devices. The plan was called the Strongpoint Obstacle System, SPOS. When presented to the then Secretary of Defense, Robert S. McNamara, he indicated that he favored the plan so much that he convinced General Westmoreland to make implementation of the barrier plan a top priority. Labeled McNamara's Wall by a cynical press, this Maginot Line concept was supposed to deter Ho Chi Minh's army from infiltrating across the DMZ into South Vietnam. Con Thien was a key component of that much-maligned barrier plan and a linchpin in the defense of the entire border region. Why Con Thien? Con Thien was a key piece of real estate. Anyone setting foot on any of Con Thien's three hillocks would realize that they had an unobstructed view for miles in every direction, an artillery forward observer's paradise. To the east, one could see along the cleared trace out to Gio Linh, another U.S. fire base 6 miles away. And beyond Gio Linh, one could observe American warships cruising in the South China Sea. An observer could see throughout the southeast portion of the DMZ, even across the Benhai River to the north. To the south was an unobstructed view of the sprawling Marine Corps military base at Dong Ha, 10 miles away, as well as the Marine fire bases at Cam Lo and Camp Carroll along Route 9. The French Army had realized the importance of Nui Con Thien long before the arrival of the Americans, as they had constructed a concrete and steel fort on the highest of the three knolls that made up Con Thien. The South Vietnamese Army, ARVN, moved on to Con Thien in early 1966, building bunkers and laying out deadly minefields, unmarked, on all of the northern-facing slopes of the three hillocks. The South Vietnamese and their American allies had observed the rules of the Geneva Agreement for many years and kept their ground forces out of the DMZ, but in May 1966, the NVA's 324B division attacked both ARVN fire bases below the DMZ, Con Thien and Gio Linh. Those attacks were not successful, but from that time forward, the Allied hands-off policy changed. Four U.S. Marine infantry battalions and a sizable force of ARVN invaded the southern portion of the DMZ during Operation Hastings in 1966, temporarily clearing the enemy forces out. The Trace. In February 1967, Camp Con Thien was established by U.S. Army Special Forces Detachment A-110. Navy Construction Battalion 4, Seabees, soon joined them and built roads, bunkers, and connecting trenches, cleared an aircraft landing strip, and put in barbed wire obstacles. It was now officially an American base. A battery of U.S. Army 175mm artillery pieces was emplaced at both Con Thien and Gio Linh to interdict enemy activities far up into North Vietnam. This proved to be too much of a threat for the NVA, and they retaliated by repeatedly shelling both bases. The big guns were then pulled back 10 miles to the Marine base at Camp Carroll, south of Route 9. Assuming responsibility for both the security and construction of the strongpoint obstacle system rankled Marine brass. They did not have the resources to do both adequately, and they loudly voiced that objection to General Westmoreland and Secretary McNamara, but their complaints fell on deaf ears. they were ordered to make do with the resources at hand, one way or the other. The U.S. Marines quietly commenced work on the barrier plan in early April 1967. Marines from the 11th Engineer Battalion, supported by tanks from the 3rd Tank Battalion and a platoon of Army M42 Dusters, were tasked with completing a bulldozed trace 200 meters wide, later enlarged to 600 meters, for 6 miles that would connect Con Thien with the other key terrain feature to the east, Jiolin. The 1st Battalion, 4th Marines, assumed responsibility for all trace and firebase security, and the Marines were there to stay. The North Vietnamese Army saw this as a significant threat. Soon, the Marines along the barrier system came under heavy enemy fire. It was an especially harrowing task for the engineers. Completely exposed while working out in the open with their ground-clearing equipment, they endured snipers, mines, mortars, and incoming artillery from the DMZ, which inflicted a heavy toll on them. Apparently, no one on General Westmoreland's staff or at the Pentagon had anticipated how strongly the North Vietnamese would strike back in an attempt to disrupt McNamara's pet project. The barrier plan was a profound threat to their entire future war of liberation in the northern provinces. The North Vietnamese upped the ante. The French Army's defeat by the communist Viet Minh at Dien Bien Phu occurred on May 8, 1954. The night of May 8, 1967, the 13th anniversary of that pivotal battle, the NVA launched a massive ground attack on Con Thien. At 0250, a green flare shot skyward from the tree line outside the southern perimeter. Almost immediately, sounding like hundreds of kettle drums beating in the distance, the booming of many mortars and artillery pieces firing could be heard all over Con Thien. Within seconds, the ground shook as hundreds of incoming rounds of artillery blasted the battered slopes and valleys. NVA soldiers, led by highly trained sappers, engineer troops, employed Bangalore torpedoes to blast huge gaps in the northern perimeter wire. Once they had penetrated the wire, they tossed C-4 satchel charges at the bunkers housing the Green Berets and Navy Seabees. 3 of the NVA attackers had flamethrowers and used them to roast several defenders crouched down in their bunkers. After they had overrun that initial defense line, the attackers headed toward what they thought were Arvin troops, but unbeknownst to them, the Arvin troops had recently been replaced by 2 companies of the 1st Battalion, 4th Marine Regiment, 3 tanks from Alpha Company, 3rd Tank Battalion, and a platoon of Marine Engineers. The NVA attacking force continued south and might have overrun Con Thien, but they ran into a stalwart bunch of Marine infantry, engineers, and tankers who fought back so fiercely that they were able to prevent further penetration. 3 tanks on the northern perimeter from Alpha Company, 3rd Tank Battalion, led by Gunnery Sergeant Barnett G. Person, fought valiantly to stem the NVA charge. Sergeant David Danner, the tank platoon maintenance man, was asleep in the tank gunner's seat when an anti-tank rocket penetrated his tank's turret and exploded, severely burning him. Danner got all of the injured crewmen to an aid station. Refusing treatment of his painful wounds, he re-entered the smoldering tank to retrieve its .30-caliber machine gun and several boxes of ammunition. Then he poured a withering volume of fire into the ranks of the attacking enemy. At one point, Danner stopped firing long enough to rescue a seriously wounded Marine he saw lying in the open and carry him to an aid station bunker. Danner would not allow himself to be treated for his wounds until the attack was over that morning. The tank commander of the 2nd tank, Corporal Charles Thatcher, also painfully wounded in the back and neck by shrapnel as he pulled an injured crewman out of the tank turret, re-entered his smoking tank and fired off all of the tank's machine gun ammunition, inflicting heavy casualties on the attackers. With all of his ammunition exhausted, he climbed down from his disabled tank and retrieved a rifle from a dead Marine. Observing an enemy RPG anti-tank rocket team about to fire at his tank, Thatcher gunned them down before they could unleash their anti-tank rocket. Gunnery Sergeant Barnett G. Person was the tank platoon sergeant. He advanced his tank to the main point of attack where his other two tanks lay immobilized, while several NVA soldiers crawled atop his tank attempting to disable it with satchel charges. Person kept his 90mm tank cannon blasting out beehive and canister anti-personnel rounds. His two machine guns sprayed thousands of bullets into the ranks of the determined enemy. His tank would be the only one still operable when daylight came. Out of 12 crewmen on the three tanks, only one survived the battle unscathed. Three tankers were dead. Surviving their wounds, Corporal Charles D. Thatcher and Sergeant David Danner would receive the Navy Cross for their heroism that night. Gunnery Sergeant Person would be awarded the Silver Star for his bravery. As the morning sun rose in the smoke-shrouded sky, vengeful Marines attacked isolated pockets of NVA and shot them down as they tried to escape. With the perimeter sealed off, making escape impossible, it was either surrender or die. Most chose to die. After the battle, our engineers buried over 200 NVA dead in a common grave outside Con Thien's northern perimeter. That May 8th battle for Con Thien was a devastating defeat that would affect General Giap's future war planning for North Vietnam. He learned that he would not be able to attack and overrun the U.S. Marines dug in at those barrier system strong points. Their tenacity and overwhelming air and artillery support were too difficult to overcome. In response to that NVA surprise attack, the 3rd Marine Amphibious Force launched a major retaliatory attack involving over 10,000 Marines and Arvin in an operation named Hickory, which was intended to once again clear the NVA out of the southern DMZ area between Con Thien and Jiolin. 20 tanks from Alpha and Bravo companies participated. A major objective of Hickory was the removal of all civilians from their homes to create a free fire zone from south of the Ben Hai to Route 9. All of those inhabitants were relocated to a government resettlement center at Cam Lo off of Route 9. Despite living in a battle zone, a surprising number of civilians had to be forced off of their ancestral lands. Operation Hickory was only a temporary setback for General Giap's North Vietnamese Army. In due time, they would be back in force. The 1st Battalion, 9th Marines, 1-9, learned this tragically on July 2nd during Operation Buffalo. In an infamous day-long battle known as the Marketplace Massacre, an outnumbered Bravo Company came under heavy attack by a regiment of NVA that included shelling from artillery positions in the DMZ. A platoon of tanks responded from Con Thien and was able to retrieve all the wounded they could find. Only 26 Bravo Company Marines were able to walk out unaided. Sadly, the bodies of 34 Marines and corpsmen baked in the fierce summer heat for several days until they could be retrieved when reinforcements arrived. Operation Buffalo, which began as a disaster for 1-9, ended on July 14th as a total defeat for the 90th NVA Regiment, which lost a reported 1,290 dead. Marine losses were 159 killed in action, KIA, and 345 wounded. The remainder of that scorching hot summer of 1967, intermittent firefights and ambushes transpired along and below the DMZ, but nothing of the magnitude previously experienced. Then, in concert with South Vietnam's September 3rd election day, the NVA bombarded Con Thien, Jiolin, and Dong Ha with their long-range 130mm and 152mm artillery ensconced in the DMZ. North Vietnam's General Giap had been ordered to take the offensive and neutralize Con Thien. From that day forth, for the next 6 weeks, Con Thien was under siege, facing daily mortar, artillery, and rocket attacks. And the SPAS barrier-building folly would continue. 1. The first day. That terrible autumn day had been a long one, but the late afternoon seemed even longer. The sun seemed almost to go backwards in the sky. I thought that night would never come. Lieutenant James A. Graham, Confederate States of America, referring to the September 17, 1862 battle at Antietam. The date was September 10, 1967. I was a 25-year-old U.S. Marine second lieutenant, waiting nervously in my commanding officer's jeep while he made some last-minute arrangements in his office. This was the all-important day I had been striving for since I joined the Marine Corps 11 months earlier, the day I took command of a Marine tank platoon. But the platoon operated out of Con Thien, not exactly a desirable place to call home. People reacted strangely when I mentioned going to Con Thien, especially those who'd been there already. I felt something ominous about the fading grins, the serious, searching stares, and I didn't like the way they wished me good luck, as if I was going to need it. Lots of it. A heavy, gray, overcast sky did nothing to ease my apprehension over what was destined to happen to me in the days and weeks to follow. The plan that morning was for the captain to chauffeur me from Alpha Company headquarters at Dong Ha to a rendezvous point called Charlie 2, C2, 4 miles south of Con Thien. There, I would officially relieve 2nd Lieutenant Tom Barry, the present platoon leader of 1st Platoon, Alpha Company, 3rd Tank Battalion. My platoon's mission was to provide direct support to the U.S. Marines defending Con Thien, a vital outpost only 1.5 miles south of the demilitarized zone dividing North Vietnam from South Vietnam. Lieutenant Barry had preceded me by only 9 days. He received 2 Purple Hearts for superficial shrapnel wounds from enemy mortar fire at Con Thien in a week. If wounded a third time, he would be rotated automatically out of country to Okinawa. I was chosen to replace Lieutenant Barry before he bought another heart, or maybe bought it altogether. Some priority scuttlebutt was circulating around 3rd Tank Battalion headquarters in Phu Bai that a major operation involving several U.S. Marine regiments was scheduled. The operation was going to commence the middle of September and would involve all Marine elements, including tanks, in a massive sweep of the eastern sector of the DMZ, certain to be a bloody encounter. I recalled my meeting with Lieutenant Colonel Chaplin, the 3rd Tank Battalion commanding officer, when he informed me that I was going up to Con Thien to take over Barry's platoon. It was right after the colonel's evening briefing. A blazing August sun was descending upon the barren horizon when he invited me to follow him into his quarters. The colonel and the battalion executive officer shared a plywood hooch with screen doors and windows to keep out invading insects. He gestured toward a battered camp chair, and I sat down expectantly, knowing something was up, something big. I respected the colonel. He was a wise man, not impressed with his own importance, and a genuine person who appreciated a good joke, no matter who told it. He was serious this evening, however, as he sagged heavily into a wooden folding chair behind his field desk. "Lieutenant Coan, we're going to have to replace Mr. Barry on Con Thien. He's been wounded twice. One more time and he leaves us. You're flying up tomorrow to Dong Ha. From there, you go on to Con Thien and assume command of 1st Platoon." I exhaled deeply, then blurted out, "That's great news, sir." Exhilarated by the prospect of my first command, yet not wanting to appear overly excited, I decided against saying more. "Okay, but remember, you are no good to us dead. Stay down in that turret, and don't be sightseeing when the shelling starts up there. You'll have a good man for a platoon sergeant, Gunny Hopkins. He's forgotten more about tanks than you know, so don't think you have all the answers. You don't. And wear that blasted flak jacket at all times, in or out of your tank, and make your men do it too. Tankers have a way sometimes of believing they're made of steel, like their tanks. And, oh yes." His voice trailed off briefly as he stared at his desktop, obviously searching for the correct words. Then he continued on in a lowered tone. "Make certain you have the facts straight on your casualties, then call them in immediately. We can't afford mistakes in casualty reporting. It affects the entire system, not to mention the next of kin who receive conflicting reports on their loved ones. And Jim, lieutenants aren't made out of steel either." Good luck to you. My life was going to take an interesting turn in the next few days, to say the least. Mentally and emotionally, I was in good shape, prepared to handle anything thrown my way, but I couldn't shake the butterflies in my stomach. Pinpointing a specific reason behind the misgivings would have helped me relax more, but it was an elusive quest. Was I afraid of dying? No, no more so than in times past when I considered my ultimate mortal destiny, and I knew intuitively I would be okay under fire. I had no reason to think otherwise. But Con Thien, with its evil reputation, that was troubling me. Danger was lurking up there, and the manner in which I found it would be a totally new experience, and the not knowing what to expect was worse, by far, than knowing. Dongha. My captain, a slender, blonde-haired officer who, although in his mid-20s like me, would have to show ID to prove he was over 21, strode purposefully over to the jeep. I detected a hint of arrogance in his voice as he asked cheerily, "Ready to shove off, Lieutenant?" "Yes, sir. I'm all ready to go, Captain," I responded carefully, determined not to give away how anxious I was feeling. "Very well, then. Let's go find that diesel fuel truck at Charlie 2 and meet Tom Barry." He retrieved a camouflage-covered steel helmet from the jeep floor, placed it securely on his head, and easily swung his long legs into the jeep. He wore a faded, battered USMC flak jacket, which was peculiar. He could have had his pick of any new ones from Alpha Company supply. The captain drove his own vehicle. Most company commanders used an enlisted man as their jeep driver. I thought this was an indicator of his style, loose and informal, but there was something detached and aloof about the man. I wasn't sure if we were going to work together well or not. Time would tell. Our little jeep maneuvered effortlessly onto the main dirt road leading through the compound, and we headed north in the direction of Dongha's main gate. The captain recounted the disaster that had occurred a few weeks earlier, when 41 enemy artillery rounds, fired from the DMZ, landed inside the perimeter of Dongha combat base and touched off a series of earth-shaking explosions that rocked the base for over 4 hours. Stockpiles of ammunition, thousands of gallons of fuel, and tons of badly needed supplies had literally gone up in smoke. In fact, an ominous black cloud of smoke from the exploding dumps billowed up over 12,000 feet and was observed as far south as 3rd Tank Battalion headquarters at Fubai. Luxuriant green fields, rice paddies, and groves of shade trees thrived on both banks of the placid Kamlo River, paralleling our route westward toward Camp Carroll. An occasional water buffalo wandered through the open fields with a bare-chested peasant boy sitting astride the beast's back. Dongha Mountain rose majestically skyward to our right front a few miles distant, completing the peaceful panorama before us. This was beautiful scenery, right out of the pages of a travel agency brochure on Southeast Asia. Neither the captain nor I appeared to desire more conversation. We sat in silence, respecting each other's mood, watching the verdant countryside pass by. Fate is a four-letter word. Americans were getting killed in this little war at the rate of several hundred per week. Officers like me were especially vulnerable because one couldn't lead men into combat by hiding in a safe place until the danger passed. Only 1 month in country, and the number of my friends killed or badly wounded was beginning to mount. I was profoundly saddened on two separate occasions earlier in the month by news of tragedy befalling two friends of mine. Lieutenant Tom Deneen, his wife pregnant, was a basic school graduate with me who requested an infantry assignment and was subsequently killed in Vietnam by a booby trap. Lieutenant Ed Duke Jory, father of a newborn infant, went to an Amtrak amphibious tractor battalion and was machine-gunned to death while leading a patrol. Some other lieutenants with whom I had attended tank school were also casualties. Steve Fitzgerald was shot through the back and critically wounded by an NVA sniper as he leaned out of his tank commander's cupola while attempting to break up an ambush on Route 9 near Kalu. He was medevaced out of country. Jim Georgakulis was wounded twice during the same battle by NVA mortar fire, and Tom Barry, 2 purple hearts in 9 days at Con Thien. Would Con Thien be my last experience as a mortal being on this earth? Was I doomed already, my fate sealed, living out my role in this tragic war drama until that chosen moment arrived when an enemy projectile with my name on it ripped into my body and snuffed out my life? It could happen. That it very well could happen was impressed upon me so vividly in the Alpha Company office back in Dongha. Nailed over the doorway outside the office was a hand-painted, wooden plaque with the heading Alpha Company Honor Roll. Beneath the bold black letters of the heading were the neatly aligned names of each honored individual, his rank, and date of death in Vietnam. It seemed like a crude gesture to me, very unnecessary and very detrimental to one's morale. Besides, one out of every 4 names on the honor roll was a lieutenant. I didn't need any reminders of how the odds were stacked. An incident occurred at 3rd Tank Battalion in Phu Bai a few nights prior to my departure for Alpha Company headquarters in Dong Ha that probably accounted more than anything for my pessimistic outlook. A short round from a friendly South Vietnamese artillery unit near Phu Bai landed directly on a plywood hut filled with sleeping Seabees in the compound adjacent to ours, 100 meters away. We heard the explosion and rushed blindly for the bunkers outside our hooch. After the all-clear signal was given, several medevac helicopters landed with their deafening rotor noise and flashing red lights to haul away casualties. Few of us slept much that night. The next morning, 2 other officers and I decided, mainly out of morbid curiosity, that we ought to go over to the CB area and see what had happened. The artillery round, 75mm, had detonated instantly on contact with a tin roof on one hut, hurling thousands of steel and tin splinters throughout the length and breadth of the building. Few of the unsuspecting CBs escaped without injury, as evidenced by brilliant red splotches on the bed linen and pillows. The rumor we heard was that 2 men were killed outright. Several others were in critical condition. Those CBs had no way of knowing that the cots they chose to sleep in several weeks earlier probably determined whether they lived or died in that split-second nightmare of flying shrapnel. It was just an unfortunate accident. Wars are full of them. But we all left there with the very sobering knowledge that men really are subject to the whims of fate. I began thinking that day, if a tragedy such as that could happen by accident in this war, sooner or later, it might be my turn to face sudden death. An uncomfortable, nagging doubt began to fester in my subconscious that a showdown with fate might turn out badly for me. Our jeep made a right-hand turn onto a dirt road, and I was quickly jarred back to reality. "This is the Con Thien turnoff, Lieutenant. We still have several more miles yet." I nodded my head toward the captain to show I understood and took note of the village spread out before us. "That's part of Camlo Village," the captain continued. "Many of those villagers were evacuated from the DMZ and Leatherneck Square during Operation Hickory that ended this spring. This road we're riding on is Con Thien's MSR, main supply route, and any attempt to overrun Con Thien will most definitely require severing this main supply artery." We passed slowly through the village. A few scrawny, barefoot peasant women in black silk pajamas and white conical hats jogged alongside the road. Each woman balanced a 15-foot pole on her right shoulder. Hanging from each end of the poles were heavy baskets full of goods that I surmised were going to market. They did not even give us a second look. Apparently, the novelty of Marine Corps vehicles had worn off long ago. My heart skipped a few beats at the realization we were getting closer. Once past the outskirts of the village, we crossed the Camlo Bridge. Then the jeep accelerated. We were in open country, a free fire zone all the way to Con Thien. Any people we observed on foot from then on were either American military or North Vietnamese, NVA. The free fire zone extended from Kem Lo north to the DMZ 9 miles away and throughout the DMZ and Leatherneck Square. This was made possible by the removal of an estimated 13,000 civilians from the area by truck, Amtrak, and helicopter during Operation Hickory in the spring of 1967. We passed clusters of CBs and engineers working feverishly with graders and bulldozers on the road. They were also clearing the undergrowth alongside the road as an ambush deterrent. Marine riflemen slouched around on the hillsides providing security. This was soft duty for these grunts because they were south of the artillery fire support base, C2, and little enemy contact had been made lately this far south. The gently rolling, shrub and grass-covered terrain was not unlike that found in parts of California, except that we were traveling north on the MSR, which delineated the far western edge of Leatherneck Square, the scene of many bloody confrontations between U.S. Marines and NVA forces the previous spring and summer. I removed a waterproofed map case from the trouser pocket of my utilities and unfolded a map of the area. Located about 2,000 meters below the southern boundary of the DMZ was a horizontal control point with the number 158 beside it, 158 meters or 474 feet in elevation. The Vietnamese words, Nui Con Thien, printed above the control point, marked the outpost my tank platoon was assigned to help defend. Loosely translated, Nui Con Thien meant a small mountain leading to heaven. To Marines zeroed in on the hill's shell-cratered slopes, Con Thien was probably something much less than angelic. As we approached the welcome gates of C2, I noticed puffs of white smoke belching skyward every few seconds from within the enclave. A 105mm artillery battery was carrying out a fire mission in support of Con Thien. The artillery firebase was protected by miles of interlaced, barbed concertina wire strung out around the perimeter. Outside of this wire obstacle was a minefield containing thousands of deadly anti-personnel mines primed to mangle any NVA trespassers. I learned a few days prior to leaving battalion that C2's minefield had claimed the lives of two engineers and a few stray cattle since its installation. No NVA were yet victims of that minefield. We passed a flak-vested sentry at the south gate and proceeded along a dirt road winding through the artillery fire base toward our rendezvous point near the north gate. Numerous 105mm howitzer barrels aimed skyward in the same direction we were headed, north toward Con Thien. "There's the truck, sir." I pointed to our right front, just inside the northern perimeter fence. A forest green USMC diesel fuel truck sat in the open by itself. Two men slouched in the truck cab, reading comic books. They sat upright as our jeep rolled to a halt nearby, and one man walked over to the captain's side of the jeep. "Did we miss Barry's tanks?" asked the captain, his voice verging on anger if we had.
"No, sir," the man drawled. "We been here an hour and they ain't showed yet." "Okay, great. Stay where you are, then. They'll be here pretty soon."
His instructions completed, the captain spun off back down the dirt road, leaving the man enveloped in a blanket of dust. We parked adjacent to an imposing bunker near the road.
"Stay here and keep an eye out for the tanks, Lieutenant. I've got some business to square away."
He sprang from the jeep and disappeared down into the bunker entrance. I sat pensively in the jeep, watching Marines come and go. I was acutely aware of my freshly laundered utilities and shined jungle boots, unmistakably an uninitiated rookie in a combat zone. The sharp blast of howitzers firing periodically startled me as I tried to relax. Soon, I was lost in thought. Looking back, my presence in Vietnam was no whim of fate, nor was it an unwelcome development. I had volunteered for this, both eyes wide open, knowing full well I was probably headed for a war zone in Vietnam someday. Not exactly an adventurer by nature, I still longed for a chance to prove myself, to be a warrior, to become initiated into that unique fraternity of combat veterans. It was an adventure, yes, but much more than that. This adventure had deep roots set down many years before. Growing up in Tucson, Arizona, I was plagued by allergies and more than my share of childhood diseases. I idolized an older stepbrother who had served as a Marine machine gunner in the Solomon Islands during World War II. Some of my most treasured belongings came from his sea bag after he returned home, a faded khaki garrison cap and a white bath towel, frayed at the edges, with U.S. Marine Corps spelled out in bright red letters. The sands of Iwo Jima and flying leathernecks were classic John Wayne war movies. I sat through them enthralled, totally absorbed in the action. The bookshelf behind my bed held dozens of paperbacks, almost all with a military theme. Plastic models of fighter planes and bombers sat on every dresser and desk in my bedroom, and colored pencil tracings of war machinery were taped to the walls. I was obsessed with things military. Then along came Tony into my life, the class bully. Fourth grade was a nightmare of fear, tension, insecurity, and humiliation. I didn't know how to fight, and he knew it. When I arrived at the bicycle racks in the morning, he and his little band of followers met me, goading me into a fight, taunting me. I was easy prey, totally unprepared for what was happening. It was good sport for him. He never tired of the intimidation tactics. I learned later on in life that the best way to rid yourself of a bully was to fight back, even if you lost. But that lesson came too late to resolve this situation. Tony eventually transferred to a different school, so we never had the one-on-one showdown that I knew would happen one day. But with each passing year, a growing resolve solidified within. Never again would anyone intimidate me or bully me, because I would defend myself with a vengeance. I took boxing lessons at the YMCA, climbed rope, did 5 different kinds of push-ups, and anything that would build me up, make me strong. I was going to be ready next time. Was I ever going to be ready? Sports, particularly football, became another obsession. From age 13 on, I lifted weights on a regular schedule, swam competitively, and ran track, but football was my passion. It was the rough contact. Each jarring block or tackle satisfied something basic to my psyche. Then, one of life's small tragedies struck in my senior year of high school. I was going to be the starter at right end. After the first 2 days of practice, my brand new football shoes had rubbed raw, oozing, nickel-sized craters into both sides of my heels. The pain was wicked. I was hobbling through practices, wincing with each step. No matter what the trainer attempted before each practice, every session was agony. One of the assistant coaches started to ride me about coasting, not hustling. In a fit of irrational anger and frustration, I quit, turned in the uniform. Many weeks later, the blisters healed, but I was too proud to ask for another chance. I was not a quitter, but I quit. How I regretted that one impulsive decision to give in to pain and cash in my chips. My house in Tucson was located 3 blocks from the University of Arizona campus. Male students often walked by my house, going to and from classes wearing their ROTC uniforms. The idea of having to wear a uniform on campus was a real turnoff for me. I knew that my next venture after high school was to attend the University of Arizona. So, in an effort to avoid having to take mandatory ROTC, I joined the Arizona Army National Guard 158th Infantry Brigade, located in Tucson. Basic training was at Fort Ord, California, and then it was on to Fort Gordon, Georgia, for training as a manual teletype operator. On returning to Tucson, after that training was completed successfully, I was placed in the Guard Unit's Communications Platoon. Next, it was on to college at the University of Arizona. Textbooks in hand, I walked the sun-baked campus each day, searching for a friendly face among the hordes of students going to and from classes. Over 20,000 of us were registered, All ages, races, nationalities, and levels of commitment were represented. I was one of the uncommitted, taking a full course load, but not sure why. Not certain I even wanted to be there, but plugging away at the coursework anyway, in the event something fired my interest enough to major in that subject. I was bored. In a desperate attempt to shore up my dreary social life, I joined one of the most prominent social fraternities on the Arizona campus, Phi Gamma Delta. I became a houseman. We housemen lived, ate, slept, and breathed fraternity. We were like brothers, feeling a closeness many family members never experience. To be able to afford my school tuition and fraternity house dues, I worked as a scully in the fraternity kitchen, serving food, clearing tables, and washing pots and pans. School holidays were spent working at my stepfather's business in downtown Tucson. I was also a lifeguard at the downtown Sands Hotel during summer vacations. My carefree college days came to a disastrous end late one night in May 1964. The evening began harmlessly enough. Several fraternity brothers and I went to a local pub to celebrate the conclusion of semester final exams. Several pitchers of beer later, it was closing time. We were all soused, thoroughly wiped out. I climbed into the back seat of Paul's Volkswagen. Chris got in the passenger seat, and we waited while someone coaxed Paul down from the roof of the pub where he was pouring beer down on the heads of departing customers. That should have been a red flag that Paul was in no shape to drive, but I was too befuddled to care. Paul drove us home, weaving recklessly, taking corners on two wheels, running over curbs. He blew out a right front tire about six blocks from the fraternity house. We bumped to a halt behind another parked VW. Paul or Chris, it matters not who in retrospect, suggested we switch tires, take a good tire from the other car, and replace it with our flat tire. I wanted no part of this drunken caper, especially since I was planning a law enforcement career after college. While they worked clumsily under an alcohol fog, dropping hubcaps, cursing, and laughing merrily, I left and walked home to the fraternity house and collapsed into my bunk on the sleeping porch. About 4 a.m., a bright flashlight shined in my eyes and a stern-faced cop whispered loudly, "You're under arrest for grand theft." My two brothers had wilted when the cops demanded to know who the third thief was. The Volkswagen theft owner had initially reported three culprits were stealing their tire. My life then ricocheted off in another direction. Rather than hire a lawyer and have my family find out about it, I chose to plead guilty to a lesser charge of tampering with a motor vehicle, a misdemeanor, and accept a fine along with my cohorts. That was a mistake. Page 2 of the local Sunday paper had an article on the incident. University students arrested for grand theft. There was my name in print. Local boy turns bad. I dreaded facing my mother, but it had to be done, thanks to the press. The year before, her husband, my stepfather, had died of a heart attack. He meant little to me. We rarely spoke, and then only when it was unavoidable. But his untimely death staggered my mother. He was the aggressive, take-charge, decisive, type-A businessman. His loss left a vacuum in her life. She was slowly rebounding, and then this had to happen. She heard my side of the story but remained stoic, only berating me for not obtaining a lawyer. She never mentioned it again. I loved her for that. Other friends and family were not so kind. I became a non-person. People I had known for years avoided me. I was summoned to the dean of students soon after the tire caper and was told the university was suspending me for one semester. "We are cracking down on student troublemakers who give the university bad publicity." I then died a thousand deaths, carrying my class withdrawal slip up the stairs to my law enforcement curriculum advisor. He was a stern, righteous, retired Detroit police captain, and he had read about me in the local newspaper. Not a word did he utter, nor would he look at me, as he scribbled disgustedly on my drop sheet. He reacted characteristically, as I had known he would, as if I were a despicable, unclean leper. A long period of depression set in. I grieved over my lost self-esteem. My plans for a law enforcement career were over. I spent the remainder of that summer and fall employed at a local hospital as a surgery orderly, counting the days until I could be readmitted to the university. Graduation from college a year later was anticlimactic. I found no great clamoring for public administration graduates, especially for ex-law enforcement majors with arrest records. The best job I could get in Tucson was as a credit manager trainee at Sears, a decent enough job, but not stimulating. I felt unfulfilled, sedentary, stifled. I wanted a challenge. My 6-year total service obligation in the Army National Guard was completed in 1966. Nearing the end of my active reserve commitment, I'd been offered a promotion to sergeant if I re-enlisted, but I turned it down, seeing no future for me continuing with the National Guard, so that was not an option. One evening in the summer of 1966, after another boring day at work reviewing credit histories, I sat down in front of the television to watch the evening news. A serious-looking Marine captain was being interviewed about a battle his unit had just fought. His self-confident demeanor and squared-away appearance started me thinking that I'd like to be on his team, so to speak. I contacted the Marine Corps recruiting office in Los Angeles to explore the possibility of me becoming an officer of Marines. The Marines needed officer material, and I hoped they wouldn't turn down a willing, qualified college graduate just because he got out of line once while under the influence of alcohol. 5 potential officer candidate school, OCS recruits, and I met at the Sands Hotel in Tucson with the Marine Officer Selection Representative. 3 of us, including me, had misdemeanor arrest records, all alcohol-related, and needed a special waiver to be accepted. My waiver
was granted. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.